escape and run for your life. We shall have a reading from Genesis chapter 19, from verse 16 to verse 18. From verse 16 to verse 18. And while he lingered, while Lot lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him. And they brought him forth, those men, the angels, brought him forth, and set him without the city. And it came to pass, when they had brought them forth abroad, that he said, one of the angels said, escape for thy life, look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all this plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. And Lot said unto them, but not so, my Lord. We are on the third day. We are on the third day meditating on this caption, escape from and escape to. In English it's very powerful. Escape from Sodom and escape to the mountain the Lord would show. But Lot said, it's not so, my Lord. I believe that we have covered 4 points. Number one, we should escape from the untoward generation. When the Bible says, save yourself from them, you have to save yourself from the untoward generation. And you should join the church. You should join the people. They are not untoward. They got the same revelation, same teaching. The Bible exhorts us, flee from fornication. Any extramarital, any sex relationship outside a marital relationship is fornication. According to the dictionaries of the world and according to our scriptures. And Jesus made it very clear, it is not only a physical intercourse in any other level, maybe hugging, maybe kissing, maybe touching, maybe thinking, in any other level, if there is eros, a man-woman sex attraction, that is fornication. We can't say that I haven't committed adultery, I haven't committed fornication because I didn't lie with a woman or I didn't lie with a man. Even the very thought is understood as fornication. And also we have to be understood spiritually, fornication is loving the world and also loving the false religious systems. When we follow the traditions or cultures based on false religious system, biblically that's fornication. In James chapter 4 we read, it's adultery loving the world when we love Christ. So we love two people, we love Christ and love the world, that is adultery. And number three, flee from idolatry. We have to flee from Christian idols also. And also idolatry has got different teachings. Covetousness is idolatry. Having excess love of somebody your own child, your own husband, more than God. You love somebody else more than God. That's idolatry. And there are certain toys. Those things can have evil effect on us. So we have to be very careful from idolatry. Number four, from vain babblings, chatterings, chatterboxes. If you are a believer, every word that you speak, you have to give an account. But every word you speak. Last week I stopped with these 20 points. In Tamil service, I didn't have much time to elaborate. 20 points. Profane or worthless, base, third-rate talks. Seer head on the page. That would affect that seer, that perfection. Then, Kelevi hel vetti page. Old wives' babies, blah, 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 blah. This vetti page. And number three, vain babblings. Number four, foolish. Number five, senseless arguments. Number six, filthy, indecent, double meaning comments. And number seven, jesting. It's not jokes, it's not humor. Just pariyasam, kindle, geli. Not a humor. Not a wit. Wit comes from the word wisdom. Or rather, wisdom comes from the word wit. Cracking a wit. Here this pariyasam, the jesting, mostly it hurts others. I'm making jokes based on their body, based on their culture, based on their race, based on their appearance, their color, teasing them. We 100% you will be giving an account to the Lord on all these things that you have done. Then pullada ketta kadina pech, evil, hurting, harsh remarks. Number 9, guile, deceit. Number 10, these fables. It's not just a story of Aesop's fables, but you just coin something, say something about somebody. Kattukada. That's not true. That's not true. You spin your own story. Then we got contentions, quarrels, some thinking that you are talking very nobly, very scientific, when we don't know anything. Number 14, hypocritically speaking. Number 15, speaking lies. Number 16, backbiting. Number 17, speaking proudly. Number 18, ungodly words. Number 19, words that can bring unbelief. Number 20, speaking against God. What do you mean by speaking against God? How does God know this? Why is God doing like this? The wicked people are prospering. Doesn't God know about it? Just questioning God like this. And the Bible says in the book of Malachi, they are speaking against God. So we have to be very careful about these things. And about all these things, you have to give an account to the Lord. Today we are going to number 5. I'll have to finish it today, but I don't know. Number 5. Separate from sinners. Separate, not only untoward. They are sinners. They are against the commandments of God. Sinners falling short of God's expectation, breaking the laws of God. They are sinners. In Hebrews 7:26, we read about Jesus. For such an high priest became us, Who is holy? He is holy. Number two, he is harmless. Number three, he is undefiled. Number four, he is separate from sinners. Separate from sinners. And this high priest is made higher than the heavens. So it's about Jesus. Jesus, holy, we understand. Jesus, harmless, we understand. Jesus, undefiled, we understand. Jesus, separate from sinners. He loved sinners. He ate with sinners. He went to sinners' house. But he was separate from sinners. What does that actually mean? The Greek word used here is koritzo. Koritzo. Koritzo means, as it is separated from, to have more meaning, place, room, between. Place, room, between. Between him and I. There's some gap. There's some gap. We have to be very careful. That gap must be there. Between them and Jesus, there's gap. So, koritzo means placed room between. And another meaning for that word koritzo, reflexively go away or depart. That word koritzo is very powerful. Reflexively, involuntarily, anichese. It's not that you touch the fire. You don't plan, think, take a decision to remove your hands. Reflexively, you remove your hands. Reflexively, you remove your hands. The same meaning is used. Koritzo means reflexively go away, depart from them, go away from them. A reflexive action. You are not just making a very voluntary decision. They are not just untoward. In your college, in your school, your friends, your relatives, violently they break laws, they tease their teachers, they copy in their exams, they don't do their homework, they indulge in fornication with the ill thought in their mind. They chat with people of other sex. They phone them unnecessarily. You know they got a dirty lifestyle. You must place room between them and you. The Bible says, Jesus loved sinners, went to their houses, ate with them. But Jesus was able to place a room between them and him. And one meaning, it's very powerful, for that Greek word, draw a divider. Draw a divider. This far, no more. You need not hate them, you can pray for them. You can say hello to them. You can invite them to your house. But you must be able to draw a line between them and you. When you talk to them, you talk to them, not on their plane, you pull them to your plane. Talk to them what you listened in the church, what you listened in their youth meeting. Tell them about your experience. Tell them what the need for Jesus. I got saved when I was 21. I got saved when I was 21. And sister got saved even when she was much younger. My dear brother, my dear sister, by nature I was a cosmopolitan. By nature I am not conservative. I mingle with people very easily. Even when we travel in the flight or when we travel in the train, I easily pick up conversation with those who are sitting by my side. I am not an introvert. I love to mix with people. And I got saved in 21. My nature never changed. But very happily, whosoever I met, I gave the gospel to them. My heart was bubbling with that salvation. I told them about my joy. Those who are traveling with the flight, with me in the flight, I tell them about my ministry, about salvation. I'm not ashamed of the cross. The time that I got saved, I love to read Oswald J. Smith's books. Probably I might have covered all his series. In one of his books he said, I can't remember that quote, "Don't give up your friends. You give them Jesus, either they will accept Jesus or they will give up you. Either they will accept Jesus or they will give up you." And I was working. I talked to my teachers. I talked to my principal. I was able to lead my principal, his wife, for baptism. I was able to lead her for receiving the Holy Spirit. I was able to lead my vice principal and her husband for baptism. I was able to lead my colleagues. One of the Brahmin teachers, on December 24, Christmas Eve, I invited him home. I spent some time with him. In my house, I was a teacher. I was able to lead him to receive the Holy Spirit. On the 31st, I took him to baptism. Today he is serving the Lord mightily. A month back, their daughter's wedding, this Brahmin man, standing on the dais, I was very proud of it. He spoke about his salvation. You give Jesus. If you are ashamed of Jesus, I tell you, when Jesus comes, he would be ashamed of you. He will not warn you. You might have taken baptism, you might have received the Holy Spirit. You may be attending a good Pentecostal church, but Jesus will not warn you. Jesus will be ashamed of you, because you are ashamed to warn Jesus today. You are ashamed. You are ashamed to share with others your salvation. You are ashamed of your Pentecostal experience. You are not proud of that. Maybe it's not out of arrogance. If it's wrong, the Lord should forgive me. One day, our education officer, highly intellectual person, our education officer met me near that hotel Sandhya on Wednesday. So my education officer asked me, "Mr. Simon, where are you going?" He's a very elderly gentleman. "Where are you going?" "So I'm going to the church for the Bible study." "Hey, where's your church?" "Down this lane, sir." "You mean that Pentecostal church?" I said, "Yes, sir." "Hey, I thought you're an intelligent man." I jokingly said, "Why, sir?" "Hey, I thought you're an intelligent man. You're going to a Pentecostal church." I said, "Sir, I think all intelligent people will go to a Pentecostal church." "Hey, what you are saying?" That's the part I said. Then I prayed, "Lord, I answered a senior person like this. If it's wrong, forgive me. But I am proud that I was attending a Pentecostal church." The time that I got married, I was working in Sishya. In those days, marriage was not attended by big numbers. I was told that our marriage was attended by about 2,500 people. From Sishya, from St. George's, from the evangelist field, I was going through, people came. In those days, there were many cars. There were not many cars. But my marriage, our marriage, cars were lined in the Purasawalkam high road from Hotel Roma's down the street. I want to have our marriage in our church. In those days, some of the believers, they love to have marriage in big cathedrals or a Methodist church. They hired that place. That must be a beautiful place for marriage. I said, where I attend, there my marriage should take place. And Annan may remember it, and Sister Blodwin and a few others. There was a gutter in front of our church. You have to cross the gutter. It's an open gutter. You have to cross the gutter and go into the church. And there was no fan in our church at the time of our marriage. There was only one pedestal fan for the pastor. I want those who are working with me in Sishya, those that worked with me in St. George's, they wanted me to see where I was attending the church. I was very proud of that. Today it's a testimony. Today it's a testimony. My dear brother, my dear sister, I was 25 when I got married, but I was proud of my Pentecostal experience. It's not a pride. It is an open confession. It's an open confession. You must be able to draw a line between you and those who are in sin. Those who are in sin. My dear brother, my dear sister, in Psalm 1, the Bible says very clearly, verses 1 and 2, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, not standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Not walking in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Number 4. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. Number 5. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. Flee from, escape from the ungodly, the sinners, the scornful. Escape from them and escape to meditating on the word of God. Escape to have a joy in the word of God. Your life will be successful. Your life will be successful. Some people, they don't love sinners, they love sin. They love to chat with them. They love to talk with them about their boyfriends, girlfriends, their jokes. Standing with them. They are not talking with them. They are not cracking the... Just standing with them. Loving their company. I feel that you are in the danger list. You are in the danger list. The Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you. So number 6, flee from carnality or fleshly lusts. Flee from carnality. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21. Sorry, chapter 2 verse 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts. Carnality, which war against the soul. You are born again. You are a child of God. And this carnality, fleshly lust, will fight against your soul. You are born again nature. Fight again, fight between Ishmael and Isaac. You are born again. You are a child of God. And you want to have a divine nature in you. And on the other side, there is carnality, fleshly lust. And these two will fight one against the other. And Peter says, you have to run from or abstain from fleshly lust. So what do we mean by flesh? Fleshly lust. Just I give a list of 20 things very quickly. Galatians 5 verses 19 and 21. Galatians 5 verses 19 and 21, about 17 things I love to tell you. Now the works of the flesh are manifest. You can't, no, I don't know. What are the works of the flesh? It is veliyarangam. It's open. It's not secret. It's not hidden. Something that you have to analyze deeply. These are the works of flesh, are lust. Number one, adultery. Number two, fornication. Adultery is an extramarital relationship of a married person other than his spouse or her spouse. Adultery is a sexual irregularity among in a married person. Fornication, even when they are not married. A sex thought or sex relationship outside marriage. They are of the lust, flesh. Number three, uncleanness. Interested in unclean things. It's all based on nature. If I say this, don't get offended. Don't get offended. A goat, a lamb will have its own taste. A deer will have its own taste. A pig, it will have its own taste. A pig, you give some something else, it may not like it. A pig may have its own taste. A dog may eat its own vomit. So the different animals have got different taste. Similarly, different people have got different taste. We can't say, it's a nature. After my conversion, I was a cine monger. I'm from the field of dramatics and I love to be in cinematography. But from the time that I got saved, a change came. God is a witness, history is a witness. Even in the TV, a trailer, I cannot have the sound of a trailer. I go to a different channel or I mute it. It's not to speak about you. I stay in different hotels. In sometimes the very big hotels. Probably I may not even time to see the news. Now my taste has changed. My taste has changed. Why I don't even switch on the TV for news? In our house, when I have my breakfast or lunch, I switch on the TV for the news. By the time the breakfast is over, the TV will be on, off. When I go out, they take me to different restaurants for lunch or dinner or breakfast, so I don't have time to switch on the TV even to see the news. Taste changes. So some people, if you are interested in unclean things, unclean talks, you are dirty, you are unclean. That's why you are interested in unclean things. Don't get offended, I'm telling you the fact. If the fact hurts you, I can't help you. You are interested in it. What is unclean? When we were in Anna Nagar, two or three college girls came to me. One girl asked me, going to cinema or seeing cinema, what is wrong in it? It's only in entertainment. Her sister was also in the college. Her younger sister was also in the college. Probably she was in the third year and she was in the first year or second year. That day her sister was not there. So I asked her, I might just think for a minute. On the beach, your boy was chasing your sister was running. And both of them just go and hide behind a boat. Say, what, uncle? Enjoy, entertainment. Entertainment. Enjoy. My dear brother, my dear sister, somebody is brutally beaten. Somebody calls it entertainment. Okay, for them it's an entertainment. The heroine is tied to a pole and the villain is going to pluck her eyes. A terrible, cruel scene. The entertainment, that shows who you are. That shows who you are. Four people, terribly, to the cry of that girl, gang rapes her. And you want to see that. Entertainment, yes, that's your taste. You want to see the gang rape of a girl, that's your taste. Dove has got a taste. Lion has got a taste. Piggy has got a taste. Somebody has got the taste for seeing the gang rape. For them, that's an entertainment. Sex is an entertainment. Violence is an entertainment. What is entertainment? That Latin word means you enter and be one with that. Enter and be one with that. That's entertainment. For somebody, sports is an entertainment. For somebody, playing is entertainment. Somebody viewing somebody else playing is an entertainment. I was a sportsman. For me, playing game is entertainment. Not sitting and somebody else playing. That, for me, that's not entertainment. I can't get any joy deriving somebody else is playing hockey. My dear brother, my dear sister, it depends upon what's your taste. Ask that girl, it's clean or unclean. Seeing pornography movie, clean or unclean. Having evil, I don't want to call that dirty. For somebody it may be holy. The Bible says it is the lust of the flesh. Uncleanness, unclean thoughts, unclean books, unclean programs. If you say that's clean, it's okay. If you say that that only satisfies, it's between you and God. It's between you and God. But I am unable to imagine how violence can be entertainment. Your father beating your mother, or the father is beating the son, the mother sitting and watching, entertainment. And son is beating the father, they are fighting. Mother says it's entertainment. Don't you see it's rubbish, nonsense? How can you say it's entertainment when you want to see somebody beating the other? You want to sit and have that as an entertainment? So we have to be very careful about it, you and I. So the unclean things. And number four, lasciviousness. In Tamil, it's beautiful for you to understand. It is more clear to you to understand. Kama vihara. Kama is nothing wrong. It's a sex attraction. Sex attraction between husband and wife. It is good. It is God-blessed one. It's a God-blessed one. Between Abraham and Sarah, even when they are 100 years old, it's a God-blessed one. But at the same time, that kama should not have vihara. It should be as God has permitted it. It is lasciviousness. Number five, idolatry. Number six, witchcraft. Witchcraft. And philosophically, witchcraft is nothing but you are desiring for evil to happen on others. You are desiring for evil to happen in the lives of others, that's witchcraft. Hatred. Variance. Number eight, variance. Irrationally differing from others. You don't see what your father says. You don't see what your mother says. You don't want to see what your pastor says. It's variance. And when your mother says, "Ma, don't do like this. Don't stand like this. Don't dress like this," variance. Immediately you get annoyed. You want to differ from others irrationally. Or you want to differ from good people. That's variance. You don't want to comply with their counsel. Don't do like, mommy, you don't know. Daddy, no daddy. Oh, it's better that I go to your hostel. I don't want to live in this house. I go somewhere else. There are many women, they don't want to live with their parents, they don't want to live with their husband. There are some men, they don't want to live with their wives. Some children, they don't want to live with their parents. They want to escape from God-blessed gardens. They don't want this discipline, that's the variance. In Tamil it said, virodham. Virodham because you are unable to comply with. You are unable to meet those needs. You don't want it. You don't want it. No, it's better. If this discipline is any particular church, you may not love to be in that church. Variance. I don't want to go there. I don't want to hear that. It's boring. I don't like it. That's the lust of the flesh. That's called the variance. Emulations. That's vairagyam. Wrath. Strife. Seditions. Not accepting the scriptures on its face values. Heresies. Speaking against God's and God's principle. 14. Envying. 15. Murders. Hating your own brother is a murder. 16. Drunkenness. Being excess in anything. It is not only taking liquor, being excess in anything. Excess in watching the TV. Excess in sleeping. The literal meaning is not taking liquor. Anything in excess. Anything in excess. Spending money in excess. Taking dress in excess. That's drunkenness, it's mentioned here. And number 17, revelings. Revelings. Jolly, jolly, jolly. Many people, they want to have that revelings. Kaliyat. Kaliyat, the Tamil word, comes from kal plus aattu. Aattam. Kaliyatam. Kal plus aattam. That type of jolly. Want to be jolly. Enjoyment is not just being jolly. As I said earlier, I was a cosmopolitan. I love always to be happy, always to be cheerful. But from the time that I got saved, I cannot imagine any time I indulge in merrymaking. Any time I indulge in merrymaking. But sure, I am very happy. Sure, I am very cheerful. Not always very melancholic, morose, keeping a 6 o'clock castile face. No. But at the same time, you have to be get rid of revelings. These are the very special things. Lusts of the flesh. And Paul says in that verse, and such like, not only the 17. If you want to add this list, you can add. And such like, of the which I tell you before, and as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things, they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. The Bible says, if you are interested in these things, you can't flee from these things, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. You cannot inherit the kingdom of God. The Bible says you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. I believe those who indulge in such things, they cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Number 7. 2 Timothy chapter 3. We have to read first 5 verses. 2 Timothy chapter 3, first 5 verses. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be, number 1, lovers of their own selves. Number 2, covetous. Number 3, boasters. Number 4, proud. Number 5, blasphemers. Number 6, disobedient to parents. We are in the perilous time. This is a prophetic time you are living in. You are living in a prophetic time. Here men are lovers of money. lovers of their own selves. They are covetous. They are covetous. And they are disobedient to parents. When I was my school days, college days, when I don't say I was a goody-goody boy or a very pussy type, very quiet, no. In my house they never expected us to be like that. We all sit and play together, laugh together, we used to go to movie together, we used to go to cinema together. We enjoyed our family life. Nevertheless, I cannot imagine a day where I disobeyed my parents, where I thought that I could disobey my parents. I was not saved. It was not nature of me because of my salvation. We were in those days. Even when I was college, I remember this. I don't know when it happened. But always I quote this. If I go out, it was cloudy. I'm in college. I go out. If my father says, he doesn't call me by even name. Mostly he calls me Raja. Raja, mala varra maari irukke. Koda eduthittu pona better la. He might not have even said, hey, koda eduthittu po. Mala varupadra, koda eduthittu poda. No, just he mentioned. Mala varra maari irukke, koda eduthittu pona better la. Had my father said that, I cannot imagine I'll be going out without taking an umbrella. It was a nature. Probably that was so with all my brothers and brother and sisters. Probably that was so with my friends. My mother, I remember, has told me, light ekarakla veetukku vandranum. We don't say, there will be only one small clock in the house. Only 1 inch, no wristwatch, nothing. Light vaikkaradukulla veettukku vandru. Maybe very rare, I would have gone back home after there was light in our house. Every evening I would run out to play hockey. Every evening. But somehow I would rush home before they could light my house. We had a nature, but we are living in a perilous time, these last days. Children, they don't want to obey their parents. It's a very common occurrence. This is a terrible, it's a perilous time. This is the evil of the time. This is one of the signs of the end time. Very easily the children will say, Daddy, you don't know. Mummy, you don't know. Be quiet. Shut up. I know. I'm grown up enough. It's a curse. It's a sign of the end time. And when they are grown up, if the aged parents are there, they don't care for that aged parents. They don't care for those aged parents. My father was with us till he could become 89. He could become 89. In the presence of God, I tell you, I can't even remember one occurrence. I can't remember one occurrence. Even when he was 89, I disobeyed my father. Thus, my wife respected my parents. Our children learnt it from us. They respected their grandparents. We cannot even imagine a trace of a situation where our son or daughter would have showed a small sign of disrespect to our old aged parents. A small sign of disrespect. There are even today families like that. There are even today families are like that. They love their parents, they respect their parents, they respect their grandparents. But the curse of the day, it's a prophecy. Perilous time has come. We are living in those times. This is a sign of the time. Disobedience to parents. So in this list of the people, here we see disobedient to parents, unthankful. They are unthankful, unholy. Verse 3, number 9, without natural affection. There's no love for the father, no love for the mother, no love for the brother, sister, no love for the teacher. You know how much we love our teachers. Teachers, they don't love their children. My teacher, who was a teacher for me in Standard 5, the day when he said that he was coming to visit me, I was excited over. So I was restless. When my teacher, who was teaching me in Standard 5, when he came to my room just a few weeks back, or a month back, I was not ready to sit in front of him. He said, "Ukaringa thambi, ukaringa pastor." Then I pulled out another chair and sat. Not my usual chair. Today, my respect for my teacher, when I think about them, is very high. Still my teacher was teaching me in Standard 4. She always inquires of me to a relative who is in contact with me. I got a desire to go and meet her. Teacher who taught me in Standard. I am what I am today. It's all because of them. It's all because of them. People are not thankful. People are not... They don't have a natural affection. Teachers don't have affection for the children. Children don't have affection for the teachers. And truth breakers. Very easily, they cut off their relationships. False accusers. Incontinent. That is, not satisfied. Not satisfied with anything. Not satisfied with the income, not satisfied with the family, not satisfied with the food, not satisfied with the relationships. Incontinent. And fears. Desperate of those that are good. They are despisers of those that are good. If anything good, they don't like it. If the pastor says something good, they don't like it. Don't do it, it's not good. They don't like it. They despise anything that is good. Anything that is good. They don't want it. And number 15, traitors. Number 16, heady. Tunichal. Patharlaan. Tunichal. Number 17, high-minded. Number 18, lovers of pleasure. Number 19, not lovers of God. Number 20, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. Hypocrisy. Having a form of godliness. They go to a Pentecostal church, they carry a Bible, they will have a cross in their chain. Form of godliness. But that godliness is not in their life. And Paul says very clearly, From such, turn away. From such, turn away. Having a form of godliness and denying the power thereof. They are not obeying their parents. They are not thankful. They are not holy. When you see these people, but they are, earlier we saw sinners. They are not born again, they are not saved. They may be atheists, they may be different religion, that's a different thing. Here they are, they got a form of godliness. Form of godliness, but denying the power there. They love pleasures, they love money, they are covetous. They got a form of godliness, ministry. I want to take Sunday school, I want to take youth ministry, this and that. They don't love others. Natural affection they don't have. They don't respect even their own mother. They don't respect even their own father. They don't have a love for their wife or their husband, their family. They love ministry. Paradoxical. They love ministry. They don't care for their own child. They'll go out to take Sunday school. They don't teach their own daughter. They don't teach their own son. They don't have a syllabus to help their own children, but they'll have a plan to help other children. No natural affection. They'll have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. We have to be very careful about at least sinners we can earmark. But these people, disobeying their parents, but having a form of godliness. No natural affection, but having a form of godliness. No gratitude, no thankful nature, but form of godliness. So when you know such people, this will be so in the end time. Among the believers, you have to turn away yourself from them. You have to run away from them to save your life. My dear brother, my dear sister, number 8, abstain from every form of evil. Now let me go a little fast. I want to finish it today. 1 Thessalonians 5:22. Abstain from all appearances of evil. Abstain from all appearances of evil. Don't ask if there's anything wrong in it or not. It seems to be wrong. It seems to be wrong. Run away from that. Run away from that. My dear brother, my dear sister, in Tamil there's a beautiful proverb. Kallu kudikiran jakrathiya veetla poi kudikiran. Paal kudikiran nee yen panamarathu kadila ukkandu kudikiran. I remember Pastor Sister Sara Navaraj used to say one illustration. All may not agree with that, but I love you to see the truth in it. She would discourage even the own brothers to take their sisters in the bike. She used to say, you are daily taking your sister to the college. You are dropping her. Everybody may not know that's your brother. Sister Saranaraj used to say, everybody may not know that's your brother. A marriage proposal comes. Somebody asks your classmates. They know a lecturer in that college. They ask that lecturer, how is that girl? That girl is okay, but every day somebody brings her in the, a boy brings her in the bike. That one small thing would mar her future. God's plan may be destroyed. It seems to be wrong, avoid it. My dear brother, my dear sister, I don't want to take it literally, and I don't want to be elaborate in it. I don't want to be elaborate in it. We can be careful about it. We have to be careful about it. Other than my wife, and my daughter was very young, I don't imagine anybody traveled with me in my scooter, my bike. While I was working, after I came for the full-time ministry, without my wife, I had never taken any woman in the car. It's not a big question whether right or wrong. I have avoided. Even emergency demands allow you to take a decision where it's between you and God. But I see something very decent. If you could follow that, I leave that to you. My dear brother, my dear sister, certain things, apparently evil, in all these years of Carmel ministries, even when I was in ACA, can anyone say that I visited any house when the sister is alone? Can anyone say? I don't say I am good or bad. What seems to be evil, avoid it. I helped some of our believers, some of our senior believers, especially brothers. Avoid this. Absolutely nothing wrong in it. Avoid this. It's better to avoid this. My dear brother, my dear sister. Sisters do come for counsel. They come alone. Nevertheless, they all know very well where that conversation would be. So here Paul says, abstain from all appearance of evil. There's no evil in it. It appears to be evil. Avoid it. Number 9, I go quickly. Flee from disorderly brothers or sisters. Flee from disorderly brothers or sisters. 2 Thessalonians 3:6. Now we command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that keep away from any brother or sister who is walking in idleness and not in accord with the tradition that you have received from us. A brother, young boy, young girl, a sister, she is not walking in the teaching you are receiving from the church. She is disorderly. She is idle, babbling. The Bible says, keep away from any brother, any sister. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, from verse 9 to 11. I wrote unto you in an epistle, not to company with fornicators. In earlier epistle, we don't have that epistle, Paul wrote that they should not have any company with fornicators. Yet, not altogether with the fornicators of this world. I told you, run away from the sinners. Run away from the untoward. But literally, you cannot running away. You cannot run from your house, you can't run from your friends, you can't run from the hotel. Somebody will be sitting there, an unbeliever, a sinner, an untoward person. So Paul says, it's not literally, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or with idolaters. For then must you need go out of the world. If you physically have to run away from them, you have to go out of the world. You are working in a school, there is an idolater. Oh, the pastor said, I have to run away from that idolater, and physically you want to run away from the idolater. No, that's what he didn't mean. Draw a line between them and you. But now I have returned unto you, not to keep company. If any man that is called a brother, any woman that is called a sister, Paul is talking about somebody, your brother, somebody, your sister. He is talking about a co-believer. If that boy or that girl is a fornicator, interested in extramarital relationship, interested in love before marriage, if you know a girl, if you know a boy, a believer, with you in the ministry, maybe in the VBS, maybe in the Sunday school, maybe in the worship team, you know a boy, you know a girl, you know a sister, you know a brother who is interested in extramarital relationship, who is covetous, or idolater, or a railer, always jesting, commenting, hurting remarks, a railer, or a drunkard, interested in anything excess. As I said, it's not only liquor, interested in food, always interested in biryani, 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 taking always a soft drinks, interested in drunkard, excess, or an extortioner, pulling out money from the parents, always fighting for money, wants to take money, he extortioners. With such an one, no, not to eat. With such an one, no, not to eat. You can't go with him. Even don't sit and eat with him. If a believer is disorderly, more than an untoward person, more than a sinner outside, more than the hypocrites, somebody close with you, somebody who participates in the communion with you, love feast with you, if you know his behavior is disorderly, you have to turn away from that believer. 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 3. If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, words which produce envy, decisions, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are deprived in mind and deprived of truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. But godliness, for many people, godliness is means of gain. The other day I saw a type of an advertisement. A karitharangi. Ooliyam, alaipa, pilaipa. For many people, ooliyam is pilaipu. They cannot do any other work and get this much of respect, this much of money. Scuffle rights. Scuffle rights. If they go as a laborer, for their background, they cannot earn this much of money, they can't earn this much of respect. This is a very good palaipu. So, but godliness with contentment is a great gain, for we brought nothing into this world and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Now listen, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through the craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. Now I come to it. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Flee these things. Pursue. Escape from Sodom. Run to the mountain I show. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. Go to that mountain. Go to righteousness. In any house, in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, in any house, there will be vessels unto honor, vessels unto dishonor. In the children of Jacob, 12, they all became the fathers of the tribes. 12 sons. Reuben, many people call their sons Reuben, the firstborn of Jacob. He went to the wife of his own father, incest. Reuben went to the wife of his own father. He is also son of Jacob. Diana, daughter of Jacob, went around to see the city and lost her chastity, daughter of Jacob. Judah went into adultery, not knowing it was his wife. He went to his own daughter-in-law. Reuben went to his stepmother. Judah went into his daughter-in-law. Simeon and Levi, murderers, deceivers, those who spoiled the name of their father, those who made the name of their father stink. In that house, there was one Joseph. About Joseph, the Bible says, separated from among his brethren. Separated from among his brethren. When he was in the prime of his youth, his father was not there, his mother was not there. He was not going behind sin. Sin was coming, not I say sin, the lust of the youth was coming behind him. With that, prosperity, position, favor, so many other things are attached. Brother of Reuben, brother of Judah, brother of Diana, brother of Levi and Simi said, how can I do this great wicked thing against God? In any church, any congregation, there can be Reubens, there can be Simeons, there can be Levis, there can be Dianas, there can be Judas, there can also be Joseph. It's a question who you are. When you see a believer disorderly, a woman or a man mocking at the teachings of the pastor, not complying with the disciplines of the church, separate yourself. Don't show as if you want to jive with those people. Some people have got they're good people, but got a bad nature in the school, in the college, in the work spot, in the church. Always they love to identify with a disorderly behavior, with a scornful. They want to identify with these rowdy groups. In the school, in the college, they may be teachers. Somebody will sit and talk bad about the principal. They want to be there. They may not talk anything. Flee from them. Put a divider. They were my colleagues. Whenever they criticized the management, I always stood with the management. I'm not bragging about myself. To encourage, my age may permit me to say this, my lifestyle to encourage you. If you want, you can be proud of your pastor. If it is foolishness, may God forgive me. I live that life, that's what I'm saying. Today God is blessing me. With all humility I say, the Lord is helping others to see a difference between me and others. It's the grace of God. The grace that was bestowed on me was not in vain. I never spoken against the management. When I was in the church, an assistant to pastors, I've been always to the core loyal to my pastors. Loyal to my pastors. That people who are not, who are in a different company, they will give a testimony for that. My dear brother, my dear sister. Somebody appreciated me for that, somebody hated me for that. Always, I'm generally called, he's an institutional man. Whatever the institution I was working in, I was for that institution. If it is wrong, I will go and talk to the head straight. I never indulge, in the presence of God I say, never indulge in any anti-institutional activity, even a talk, even a word. This is what God taught me. This is what God taught me. This is what I inherited from my family. This is what I inherited from my pastor. From my pastor. My dear brother, my dear sister, even in the church, if you see somebody disorderly, you have to keep yourself away from that. Don't try to have a pleasure in being a company with some rowdy goomba. Anywhere, in any work situation, you are a child of God. That's your identity. Keep your identity. And the tenth one, I say this today and conclude. Depart from iniquity. Depart from iniquity. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 19, that God's firm foundation stands bearing this seal. Your baptism, your dedications, your ministry, your godliness should bear this seal, approved. Shuck. Shuck. But God's firm foundation stands bearing this seal. In English, it's put within the quotes. The Lord knows those who are His. The Lord knows me. The Lord knows me. How many of you think that's a great confidence for you? The Lord knows. The Lord knows. That's a sure foundation. I'll explain it in a minute's time. The Lord knows those who are His, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord, those who speak about God, those who name the name of God. The Bible says, depart from iniquity. Not only from sin, iniquity. The word iniquity in Tamil, it's beautiful. Anything other than karma. Anything other than karma. Karmathukku mar akramam. Whenever that word a is added, it gives the negative meaning. Niyayam, aniyayam. Nidhi, anidhi. Yukti, ayukti. That word, the letter a, brings the negative meaning. Karamam, akramam. If you are using the name of the Lord, you say you are a Christian. You are a Christian. What is the seal? Having a cross and no jewels, wearing white. What is the seal that you are a Christian? What is the seal that you can use the name of God? You depart from iniquity. You depart from iniquity. You don't depart from iniquity and you say that you are a Christian, you are not standing on a sure foundation. The Bible says. The Bible says you are on a sinking ground. You are on a sinking ground. And what is the cause for this effect? God knows. God knows. God knows. God knows why I am late. Will I go late like this to get a train? If there is a program where the chief minister or the minister comes, will I go like this? I despise God's table. I despise God's service. To catch a train, I will not go like this. But I mean, this is the sure form. At the same time, God knows. God knows. It's not because I despised. In spite of, there was a problem. My vehicle got punctured. The usual train hasn't come. There is a reason which I cannot overcome. So what is the sure foundation? It's not what pastor knows, what God knows. That's why I said, God knows is the greatest problem for us. God knows why you are late. Not only for this late coming. Depart from what is iniquity. What is not the kramam? What is not orderly? Depart from that. That is the seal of your sure foundation. That is the seal that you are a Christian. That is the seal that you are following God. Not your ministries. Not your dress. That's not the seal. You want to depart from iniquity. My dear brother, my dear sister, I have shared with you 10 things. This day I went very fast and covered 5 things, 5 or 6 things to complete this message. Number 1, save yourself from the untoward generation. Number 2, flee from fornication. Number 3, flee from idolatry. Number 4, flee from vain babblings. Today we saw 6 things. Separate from sinners. Draw a line. Place a gap. Separate from sinners. Flee from fleshly lust. I gave a list of 17 points. Flee from disorderly brothers and sisters. Or rather, flee from hypocrites. Those who have got the form of godliness and denying thereof. Flee from them. Number 8. Abstain from every form of evil. There's evil in it or not. If that appears to be evil, try to abstain from it. Number 9. Flee from disorderly brothers and sisters. Those who call themselves brothers and sisters. There may be a Judah, there may be a Reuben, there may be a Diana. Try to flee from disorderly brothers. Vessels unto honor. Number 10. The last but not the least. Depart from iniquity. And the Bible calls it very clearly. Allow to read that verse and conclude. But God's firm foundation stands. Bearing this seal, the Lord knows those who are His. The Lord knows. And let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Not only from evil, not only from sin, anything that is not criminal, anything that is not required of you. wherever, whatever you do, don't be fall short of the expectation of the others. Fall short of the expectation of the others. That's a sure seal of the sure foundation. And if you name the name of the Lord, depart from iniquity. As calling ourselves Christians would become a blasphemy. Calling ourselves Christians would become a blasphemy. And especially in the matters connected with the Lord, don't despise the Lord. Don't despise His table. Don't despise His assemblies. Don't despise His bread and His wine. Don't despise His sacraments. Don't despise His hours. Anything that is connected with the Lord, let that be very serious for you. That decides whether we go to heaven or go to hell. That decides whether we can have blessings or we can have curses. That decides our success or failure. Our acceptance, our rejection. Shall we pray? What the Lord says escape from, escape from. What the Lord says escape to, escape to. Escape from Sodom, escape to the mountain the Lord shows.